Thanks for watching the daily debate on Thursdays with Tahrir Hussein on Nile TV International. And we have all the pleasure and honor to celebrate on that special episode with India tonight, India's 68th Republic Day, a very important event in India's history. Republic Day is usually a holiday that falls on January the 26th each year. And it's usually a day to remember when India's constitution came into force on the 26th of January of 1950, completing hence the country's transition towards becoming an independent republic. On that important note, we have all the honor and pleasure of hosting His Excellency, Ambassador Sanjay Bhattacharyya, India's ambassador to Egypt. Thank you so much, Excellency, for coming to Nile TV to celebrate with us this important day in India and also today in Cairo, India's 68th Republic Day.
Good evening. It's always a pleasure to be here, and good evening to all your viewers.
Well, starting off with the 68th Republic Day, a very meaningful day in India's history. Tell us more, Excellency, about this sense of transition into becoming an independent state, India as an independent state, and how is that special day well celebrated in India at large?
Well, as you know, we became independent in 1947 on the 15th of August. And that's a very special day for us because we celebrate that as our Independence Day. However, even before we had got our independence, we had started in our nationalist movement the work towards writing out our constitution. And the Constituent Assembly was actually formed in 1946, and it began its sessions immediately after that. But the main sessions really began operating after independence. And they worked very hard till the 26th of November of 1959, when the Constituent Assembly met to finalize. That was the last meeting of the Constituent Assembly to finalize the Constitution. And I think the most significant thing about the Constitution was the preamble, in which they outlined the main charter. So they said, "We, the people of India, give ourselves the Constitution." And it was a symbolic gesture of an independent state moving towards full democracy and deciding to be a sovereign republic. And we chose the 26th of January of the next year, 1950, to be our first Republic Day, because in 1929, on the 26th of January, at the Congress in Lahore, we had held the Purna Swaraj, or the Complete Independence Declaration. Right. And so to commemorate that Complete Independence Declaration, we now celebrate 26 January as our Republic Day. It's a very special day.
A very special day, and we are celebrating India's special day on Nile TV International tonight. Excellency, tell us more about the features of the celebrations. We know that we have military parades in different Indian states, in state capitals, in Delhi and more. It's a festive day. It's a day of pride for India.
Of course, this is a day when we actually became a democracy. It's the day when we gave hope to the young people. We assured freedom, dignity, equality, fraternity, and justice to all our citizens. And we all worked towards it. On the 26th, it starts off early in the morning with a parade in Delhi in what's known as the Rajpath. So it leads from the President's Palace down towards the National Stadium. And the President comes early in the morning to take the parade salute. The initial contingents are military contingents which march past. We also display various achievements in the military field. We have had recent successes in terms of under the Make in India, of making a lot of military weaponry and products. But I think the fun part really happens after that, because immediately after the military parade, following that, are the young people and the states of India, because, as you know, we are a federal structure. The first set of people after the military parade is a set of young children on elephants. And these are the children who have won the bravery awards for exceptional deeds in the course of the year. And then we have the states, which show their dance and some of the features of their economy or their society. And it's a very, very festive affair. The evening, the president holds a tea for the distinguished guests. And it's a similar scenario which is enacted in all the states of India. It's an event where the young people and the old people get together to celebrate this momentous landmark.
It is a momentous landmark and definitely a day which is really special to all Indians. And congratulations, Excellency, on that special moment and on that special day. While we are celebrating India's Republic Day, we'll share India tonight, the celebration on the 26th of January, that important note. Let's watch this report on a sense of commemorating India's Republic Day, and we'll be back.
Many people throughout India celebrate the nation's Republic Day, which is a gazetted holiday on January 26 each year. It is a day to remember when India's constitution came into force on January 26, 1950, completing the country's transition toward becoming an independent republic. Much effort is put towards organizing events and celebrations that occur on Republic Day in India. Large military parades are held in New Delhi and the state capitals. Representatives of the Indian Army, Navy and Air Force and traditional dance troops take part in the parades. A grand parade is held in New Delhi and the event starts with India's Prime Minister laying a wreath at the Amar al-Jawan Jyoti at India Gate to remember soldiers who sacrificed their lives for their country. India's president takes the military salute during the parade in New Delhi, while state governors take the military salutes in state capitals. A foreign head of state is the president's chief guest on Republic Day. Awards and medals of bravery are given to the people from the armed forces and also to civilians. Helicopters from the armed forces then fly past the parade area, showering rose petals on the audience. School children also participate in the parade by dancing and singing patriotic songs. Armed forces personnel also showcase motorcycle rides. The parade concludes with a fly past by the Indian Air Force, which involves fighter planes of flying past the dais symbolically saluting the president. These leave trails of smoke in the colors of the Indian flag. There are many national and local cultural programs focusing on the history and culture of India. Children have a special place in these programs. Many children receive gifts of sweets or small toys. A Prime Minister's rally also takes place around this time of the year, as well as the Lok Tarang, the National Folk Dance Festival, which occurs annually from January 24th to January 29th.
Strategic relations binding both countries, Egypt and India, laid the foundation, definitely, Excellency, the latest visit by His Excellency President Abdel Fattah al-Sisi to India, and the new chapter of relations between both countries. That visit had fruitful dimensions, name it, in the different fields. Politically, both leadership saw eye to eye vis-a-vis regional and international challenges, and also security-wise, also seeing eye to eye in means of combating terrorism and more.
Absolutely. As you would know, the visit of President Sisi was the third time when our leaders met in a window of 12 months. And this, as you know, is unprecedented in modern times, when the leaders of two states of Egypt and India have met so close in proximity. And the reason why this happened was because of the very close bond between the two peoples, reflected in the chemistry between the leaders, and their deep commitment to take this relationship to its rightful level. And what they did in the last state visit of President Sisi to India was to outline in the joint statement the parameters, the architecture of how they wish to see this relationship go. And quite fittingly, they called it a new partnership in the new era.
Yeah.
This recalls the very close partnership that we had in the past and builds upon that.
Yeah.
To see what are the opportunities and challenges of the 21st century.
Definitely. And if we can emphasize more on the sense of partnership, it's a new partnership in a new era. And as Your Excellency mentioned, it's that chemistry between the leaders that had laid this sense of a foundation for this new era to start. So if we're talking about the sense of partnership, namely in the different dimensions.
I think you said it.
Yeah.
You know, the first thing that India and Egypt mean to each other is what we mean to everyone else, because we are natural leaders in our regions, and we have a deep sense of commitment that comes from the ancient civilizations that we come from. So the first thing, as you mentioned, is how do India and Egypt work together on regional and global issues? And that's where there will be so much to do, whether it is on issues like terrorism, how we counter such tendencies, whether it is on larger, broader issues like trade or climate change. And these are areas in which we are working together. Of course, at the bilateral level, the cooperation is very, very focused. We have very, very strong understanding on the security requirements in our respective regions and how we can work together to bring about greater understanding in combating terrorism, in fighting radicalism and extremism, how we can combine our forces to have closer defense cooperation, for instance. And I think we've seen tremendous progress through the exchanges of the visits of the national security advisors in this particular area. I'm expecting a lot more to happen in 2017, including ministerial visits, which will bring us much closer on the political security spectrum of cooperation.
Definitely more dimensions to open, and the sky is the limit in relations between both nations. Let's watch together more concerning that important visit by President Abdel Fattah al-Sisi to India earlier that laid actually the foundation of this new era of partnership to start between the two countries.
Filling year in 2016 as the leadership of the two countries agreed to step up their defense and security cooperation to tackle the twin challenges of terrorism and radicalization, beside enhancing economic and people-to-people engagements. President Abdel Fattah al-Sisi signed a maritime transport agreement with Indian Prime Minister Narendra Modi during the president's three-day visit. The two leaders also agreed to step up military and counter-terrorism cooperation. Sisi concluded his meeting with Prime Minister Modi by inviting him to visit Egypt. A series of decisions to combat terrorism were taken in wide-ranging talks between President Sisi and the Indian Prime Minister, as the two countries have been engaged in staving off the threat of extremism and radicalism. Identifying terrorism as one of the gravest threats, they decided to have greater information and operational exchanges apart from ramping up defense cooperation, signaling a major shift in ties. Both sides also inked a pact on maritime transport, which will facilitate maritime commerce and transit of naval vessels. After the talks, Modi said at a joint press conference that Egypt was a natural bridge connecting Asia and Africa, stressing that India was ready to be a reliable partner to Egypt in fulfillment of its developmental, economic and security goals. For his part, President Sisi said Egypt was looking forward to cooperating with India in all fields, especially on the governmental and public levels. Sisi also stated that he had given instructions to the Egyptian government to develop a plan to increase economic development, military and security cooperation with India. Earlier, Indian President Pranab Mukherjee held an official reception ceremony for President Sisi. He also visited the tomb of Mahatma Gandhi in New Delhi. During his visit, Sisi also met with members of the Egyptian Indian Business Council and the representatives of three major Indian businesses, including automobile manufacturers Tata and Mahindra, as well as finance conglomerate Hinduja, where they showed interest in participating in Egypt's national projects. Sisi expressed his hope that more Indian companies open up shop and participate in developing the Suez Canal development area, noting that Egypt is particularly interested in benefiting from India's experience in developing the SMEs and IT sectors. This is Sisi's second visit to India in less than a year.
Well, as we saw, Excellency, that bond of friendship and this new partnership in a new era that we were talking about, and that takes us from talking about the political story to the story of business and finance and the economic bond between both nations. Actually, Egypt has lots of potential to offer, and I guess India sees this window of opportunity.
Absolutely. I think of all the areas of cooperation that we have between India and Egypt, the one that is most buoyant is really the economic connection. President Sisi, during his visit, laid great emphasis on the desire to cooperate, and he met with business groups. He laid out the agenda of how we can work together. Indian companies have also been very excited about their long-term prospects. As you know, there are about 50 Indian companies, and their investments have crossed $3 billion in Egypt. And the most exciting thing is that every year we find new companies coming in for investments. And at the same time, we also see that the existing companies are expanding their operations. So it's a very, very exciting area.
Definitely an exciting area, and we are cooperating together in more than one field, name it, agriculture, agro-processing, aromatic plants, herbs, textiles, IT, what more?
Exactly. I'm very excited about this. Last month, we had the great pleasure of organizing a visit by the Federation of Egyptian Industries, FEI, to visit India. They were hosted by FICCI, and they had a range of meetings with people across the small-scale sector and SMEs, and how to energize industrial sectors. And now CII will be sending a return delegation in a week's time from now, in early February, to meet with their counterparts. They will also be looking at the possibilities of cooperation and setting up ventures in the Suez Canal Economic Zone. As you know, a lot of the Indian investments are already along the Suez Canal, but I think they find this a very, very attractive domain. What my industry and my corporate sector is excited about is the continuing reforms that have taken place in Egypt. The economic reforms make it a much more attractive and a much more transparent place to live and work in. They're also looking forward to the final shape of the investment law and the other laws in the economic area, because that will in many ways be very, very helpful in drawing new investments.
Definitely, and we are very much interested also in a sense of cooperation concerning SMEs, the small and medium-sized enterprises, and I guess we have cooperation in that field as well.
I think for countries like India and Egypt, which have large populations, which also have a very large portion of their population that is young, it is very important to have the right kind of technology which provides sufficient employment opportunities. And SMEs are often the best solution for that. In the field of SMEs, I'm very happy that we have actually had good collaboration till now, and it is progressing on the right track. We have also been working in the area of skills, because the world is changing so rapidly today that it is important for the young people to be able to skill themselves, not only for the technologies of today, but also for the technologies of the future. Mm-hmm. And this is some of the effort that we are doing. I see great prospect, for instance, in small-scale textile units. We have a vocational training center that mm-hmm. we have established in the field of textiles, which is doing extremely good work. Mm-hmm. But SMEs, of course, across the range will be something will have great potential.
Great. Well, taking from what Your Excellency have just mentioned, and that was my next question, which is a sense of cooperation in the field of vocational training. Yes, we need to work on our youth skills. Yes, we are countries with high population, but we need to turn them into a treasure, as we can say, so to speak. So, especially in the field of technologies, and India is very advanced in IT as well. So, tell us more about an exchange program, and while we are celebrating the youth again in Aswan, in a very important conference, and while the president is always treasuring the potential that Egypt's youth can offer, whether in decision making, in leadership, in with their sense of belonging to the country, they are the future. So what can we do together in that field of exchange?
You know, the most wonderful asset that mm-hmm. Egypt has, as I see it, is its people. Mm-hmm. And you have the brightest young people that's available anywhere. I'm very, very excited about the youth cooperation. The vocational training center that you mentioned is one which is in Cairo. It's mm-hmm. in Shubra. It will provide training to about 300 people every year. And the beauty of it is that they will be using the latest technologies, the latest machinery, computer-aided design. And so once they do the program over there, they will have ready-made jobs available in the apparel sector. And as you know, there are a number of Indian companies in that sector as well who would be very happy to take them on. But I think we also need to move between intermediate technologies and higher technologies. Mm-hmm. And I'm very happy that we are going to have a very, very useful delegation coming in the field of IT towards the end of next month. Mm-hmm. We'll be doing a seminar on IT, which will be sponsored by NASSCOM, which is the apex body for IT in India. So this will provide the opportunity for interaction between the IT majors of mm-hmm. India mm-hmm. and the very, very remarkable talent pool that you have in Egypt in the field of IT, for training as well as for IT services. Mm-hmm. Because, you know, today what we find is that in many of the areas, whether it is manufacturing or retailing or hospitality, IT plays a very, very important role. So I think that is a connection that I'm really looking forward to making. We have, for instance, as you probably know, the iTech program, which is the Indian Technical and Economic Cooperation program, under which young people go for exchange, go to India for training for short-term periods, which is between 2 weeks to 1 year.
Right.
So it's not really a degree. And I'm very happy that since I'd come here a little under 2 years ago, there were 40 slots for Egyptians. And last year, we were able to increase it to 110.
Great.
I'm so happy that this year, it's going to be 200.
Great.
So because this is the kind of exchange that was envisaged in the past as well, South-South cooperation, because the kind of technologies that we need, the kind of situations that we work in are so similar that we'd be very, very better off if you were to share that.
Definitely, and we share a lot together, and we share also our love for Africa and what binds us together. I know that the India-Africa conference that took place last October was very significant. And we are eyeing such events. It's very important. Africa to Egypt is very important as well.
You know, just as you are part of the African continent, although we are separated by the sea, we have always felt that we are part of Africa too, because our connections are very, very historical, very, very deep. So many Indians live in different parts of Africa. Our trade today is of the range of about $70 billion with all of Africa put together. So we have a very, very significant interest in this young continent that has so much of potential and doing so well. We work with Africa essentially in capacity building. So we have a lot of training programs, infrastructure development, and it's been a very, very profitable, mutually beneficial relationship, because at the end of the day, again, as I said for Egypt, the greatest asset that Africa has is its people. And today we find that the young people of Africa are coming forward in the frontiers of science, in the frontiers of literature and art, and contributing. And that's where we would like to interact with them. When we did the Africa Summit in 2015, President Sisi was one of the very, very highly respected participants at that. We had announced a project by which we would provide infrastructure development facility through lines of credit of a $10 billion envelope. And we would love to do that with Egypt as well, to utilize the opportunity to use the lines of credit and Exim Bank guarantees for infrastructure projects in Egypt.
Definitely a very important asset. And after the president's visit to India, he attended the G20, where Egypt was the guest of honor of the year summit upon the invitation of the Chinese president. So we are continuing a sense of cooperation, and Egypt is opening up to the whole world. If we speak culturally, lots of bonds together. And India by the Nile has been actually a huge success. So we're expecting more, Excellency, in that dimension.
Well, you know, this is a very special year because 2017 is the 70th anniversary of our independence. It is also the 70th year of the formalization of diplomatic relations between our two countries. And it's the 5th anniversary of India by the Nile. So we would like to make it very special. We've been working for almost 1 year for this particular event. We hope to launch it in early March, and this time it'll be longer than before. So it'll carry on till the end of April. So it'll be on for a little over 6 weeks. It'll have the usual features, but I think it'll have many interesting surprises. The focus for India by the Nile this year has been on more collaborative work with Egyptian partners. It is also focused on working with youth themes. And of course, it'll have some of the old themes coming back. For instance, we will have a separate section on Gandhi, because Gandhi is such an amazing person.
Very symbolic, definitely.
He is a person whose principles transcend time, transcend boundaries.
Right.
His concept of adherence to truth and nonviolence is one way that I think we can find answers in our troubled world and troubled lives.
Definitely an icon, Gandhi. And that brings us to another dimension in the cultural exchange program, like, for instance, Egypt is celebrating the Cairo International Book Fair, and India shares in the book fair. So we need to see more and read the stories of success of those Indian legends and icons to be there, and vice versa, for Egyptians to know more about Indian legends and Indians would know more about Egyptian legends too.
I couldn't agree more with you. You know, that's so true. I think we need to get the interest of studies of India and Egypt back to our textbooks.
Yeah.
I remember when I was in middle school, we used to study about Egypt. And that's where I think this fascination for this beautiful country began. We need to have more of such efforts so that there are departments in universities that teach about each other's countries, our social systems. We've made a very small beginning in the Ain Shams University. As you know, we have a culture center where we teach some Indian languages, and we teach yoga and dance. But we've made a small beginning at the Ain Shams University with the teaching of Hindi. Mm. And we would like to expand that further to different aspects of India. We have also expanded our scholarship scheme. So today we have about 24 Egyptian students who go to India. Mm-hmm. We've also started some exchanges between think tanks so that, you know, there is more collaboration at the research level. And you mm-hmm. mentioned, you know, I think we really hope that there is more exchanges between the media as well.
Yes,
and
definitely.
And you're working on that.
Yes, definitely. We need to work on that as well, and dramas and operas and more in utilizing what we call both countries' soft power in that dimension.
I agree entirely. You know, what we have tried on behalf of India is that we take part in as many of the cultural festivals that you have. So we take part in
Smalia.
Aswan, mm-hmm. in Luxor, in Upper Egypt,
yeah.
In the festivals that you have over there.
Yeah.
In fact, the Aswan fair is going to be in February, in the mm-hmm. middle of February. And we're going to have a Kalaripayat group coming from the southern part of India, from Kerala, to take part in that. We will also be taking part in the Ismailia and the mm-hmm. Alexandria fairs. Mm-hmm. We have now become a regular feature in the Alexandria Summer Festival, where they bring in theater and dance and literature. And we're very happy that we've been able to be the opening country in the inaugural event last year. And we will put in with much more. We're going to have a theater festival in Alexandria at the end of April this year.
Mm-hmm.
And we will have a very interesting concept of a Gandhi puppet theater with a Gandhi theme. But it's a puppet theater, which we'll bring to the Alexandria Festival. I think it's going to be fantastic. We also want to promote more exchanges and translations of books.
Yeah, definitely.
I find that there is some interest in some of our classics, like Tagore, or the writings even of Gandhi or Nehru are popular over here. But we would like to do more in terms of the more contemporary literature. In our Sotal Hind, the magazine that we bring out in the embassy, we are now trying to introduce a section in which we would start off with smaller translations and then gradually move towards fuller books.
Yeah. You know, Excellency, it's that sense of interest in each other's culture in India in itself. We love Indian art and music and culture and the Indian beat, the flavor. That brings us to the cuisine flavor as well, which is again binding both nations. Aren't there going to be a sense of competitions in that direction? Something quite unconventional in that field as well.
I think that's a brilliant suggestion. Cuisine really binds people a lot together. We have tried the food fiesta over here, and as you might have noticed in the last India by the Nile, we had tried to bring in what is known as Indian fusion cooking, which is the ingredients are all Indian, and the manner in which the dish finally comes out is Indian, but it is produced in the most modern techniques. So for instance, you know, they would use nitrogen vapor to make globules, or they would have fusion cooking with some influences from other parts of the world.
Mm-hmm.
And then rather than have just curries for everything, you would have a plated service mm-hmm. like you have in a French meal.
Mm-hmm.
And as you know, Indian cuisine is now becoming quite popular, and some of our chefs have been winning Michelin stars. So we had brought one such chef last year, and I'm very happy that he's coming again for India by the Nile, and it should be a terrific event. We're going to do it at one of the hotels over here.
That would be great, and I guess it's going to attract many visitors. A short break, and we'll be back.
Thank you.
So lovely scenes, as we see beautiful India. How about tourism? Well, that important file is definitely there as a priority.
You know, I'm very surprised that we don't have more people traveling to each other's countries, but we're working hard on that file as well. We have both beautiful countries, and it's so important for people to actually go and visit and see what happens over there. I did a tourism seminar earlier last year to bring together some tour operators from both India and Egypt. It has had very good positive results because I find that the flows both ways has gone up. The flow from Egypt to India has gone up about 10%. The flow from India to Egypt has increased considerably more because Indians are just in love with Egypt. I think what we really need to do is showcase these packages so that once you go and visit India, you will forever be in love with it.
Definitely, I'm sure of that. And that's why when we bring India by the Nile, the combination itself becomes fabulous, you know, this sense of bringing both countries' charm together.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. You will not imagine the kind of impact India by the Nile has, I'm not saying in Egypt, but back in India.
Yeah.
Because when the stories and the pictures of India by the Nile go back to India, and you know there's a group of media persons who come here to cover the event and then they go back, Indians are enchanted to see what they actually witness. So this year, for instance, we are planning to have the yoga session by the pyramids. And you can imagine the number of Indians who would be excited to come and visit the pyramids after that.
And
we want this to continuously grow. What we have found is that there's great interest now in something that is called the Holy Circuit. And so Indians come to Jordan, Jerusalem, and Egypt to complete
The circle. Yeah. Excellency, many important issues on the agenda and a sense of cooperation in more than one dimension. We talked about the youth and engaging them in those important agreements in the field of vocational training, in education, and more. How about women? And we are believers in women empowerment.
Well, I've always believed that a nation is only as strong as its women are. That the extent to which any society empowers its women provides it with the ability to grow. And the reason for this, in my mind, is very simple, because the woman is the pillar, the fulcrum of the family. What the woman does and feels is what it imparts, she imparts to the child, is what then endures. And so it's extremely important that we recognize, we have tried to look at this issue in India from different perspectives. There is a cultural dimension, there is a political dimension, and there is an economic dimension. In the case of political empowerment, I think we have made significant progress. So I must confess that the Egyptian parliament has more women than we have in our Indian parliament. But my speaker in India of the parliament is a lady. And the chief ministers of many of my states in India are ladies as well. What we've actually been able to do is that at the grassroots level, at the village level, we have by regulation enforced that there will be certain places where the committee that looks after the village, we call it the panchayat, will be composed of women, and in some cases definitely headed by a woman. And we found that development in such areas becomes brighter, more transparent. It's empowerment which is necessary to realize the potential. As you know, when we did the Mars program, the leader of the mission control was a woman.
Was a woman, yeah.
And this is across
a sense of trust and a sense of pride. Well, a short break, and we're still on that exclusive interview on the daily debate with His Excellency Sanjay Bhattacharyya, Ambassador of India, while we are celebrating the 68th anniversary of India's Republic Day, that important note, and that day which is a source of pride for all Indians. Stay with us, and we'll be back. People relations.
This is the first time I am here as you.
First interview exclusively, Excellency.
Thank you for the kind invitation.
In the name of Allah, we crossed. How was it that since that moment of crossing?
Actually, this is the fourth time of mine being here.
Celebrate Ramadan and Eid. Has been very special.
We have our annual iftar. We celebrated this year.
You're still watching the debate, and Excellency talking about a very important dimension, as well as our sense of cooperation in the field of science. Science and technology is also on top of the list.
You know, today we are in the world of technology, and technology comes from science. If we are to move ahead and close the gap with the developed countries, it is extremely important to focus on science and technology. And there are, as we see it in India, it's in two parts. One is the education research, which is extremely important. And equally important is the aspect of innovation, which comes about through industry, the interaction with the market. And very happy that we are actually working in several areas on this. We have a scholarship fellowship program called the C.V. Raman Fellowship, mm-hmm. under which we have, at the moment, six Egyptians who are doing postdoctoral work in some of the leading institutes in India. But I think the scientific collaboration extends further. A large number of the people who go on the ITEC are also doing areas like meteorology mm-hmm. or agricultural science. One area in which I think there is huge potential is the area of space.
Definitely,
this is unconventional. At the frontier of science, mm. and I think there is huge potential, which has now begun to be discussed. We had held the first joint working group on space, and we had agreed on five different areas of cooperation in which progress is being made. We are now making preparations for the next meeting of the working group. At the same time, we are excited about the decision in Egypt to have its own space agency, because in many ways this will make collaboration much, much easier. We would be very happy to work with Egypt in the area of satellites, fabrication of satellites, the launch facilities for such vehicles, and we have very good capabilities in this. And finally, in the case, in the situation of data, remote data that you get from space, from the satellites, which have wide applications, whether it is for urban planning or education, and many, many others.
Yeah, and this brings us also to education, and education is considered to be a very important field in our sense of cooperation, and it is the core, you know, education excellency is the core of all, every advancement in the different spheres and specialities. How can we move forward in that important file?
You know, this was an area that was also touched upon when my leaders had met in Delhi last year, during the visit of President Sisi. We had seen that there is great interest and possibilities for complementarities. We established the first Indian chair in Ain Shams University last year. This was not just the first Indian chair in Egypt, but in the entire Arab world. And we brought along with us a professor of biotechnology to teach courses at Ain Shams. That's one part of it. But I think what it's progressing towards is departmental to departmental cooperation, so that the fields of IT and communications, the fields of engineering, the fields of medicine, accounting and management, and many others are now beginning to cooperate between different universities. We've also seen an interest in getting Indian professors in some of these areas by some of the universities, and I think that would be a very, very positive development. The final area of cooperation that I think, and we've just started work on that, is the possibility of seeing whether there could be an opportunity for an Indian school in Egypt.
Yeah.
You know, we have Indian schools all across the Gulf area, and they're extremely popular because they teach the Indian system of education, which is a very rigorous system, but they also give the opportunity of going through an international curriculum in the school.
Right.
And so that is a new opportunity that we are looking at. And discussions have just begun.
Very, very good. And that brings us also, since we're talking education, talking about exchange of visits in the educational field, and talking about missions going to India, whether to learn or on vocational training. So this brings another bond, which is people to people, people working on people to people relations and popular diplomacy, and its role in working hand in hand and in parallel with state diplomacy.
Oh, exactly. You know, I think at the end of the day, people make any relationship. I've seen this growing numbers of groups going from Egypt to India as well. Very soon, sometime next month, we will have the Suraj Kund Mela, which is a very large cultural festival, at which Egypt will be the partner country. So we are very excited about that, and they will be taking a very large contingent. In fact, we had worked together with my colleague, the Egyptian ambassador in New Delhi, to realize this. And my external affairs minister is very, very keen to realize this. The other thing that is happening on the Egypt to India front is that just as we have in India by the Nile, we will, towards the end of this year, also hopefully have an Egypt by the Ganga festival.
Yeah.
And I think this is the confluence that we are looking at. In the field of people-to-people connections, I think it is extremely important for many of the NGOs to be connected. There are many issues in our society that are very alike. For instance, how do you deal with the issues of street children, for instance,
which
both of us have? As you know, during the last India by the Nile, we had a seminar on this issue.
Brainstorming issues where we both have like similarities or maybe similar challenges.
And how do we bring about innovation through the non-corporate sector? These are issues that I think we need to get the young people in particular more excited about.
Our creative minds also.
Excellent. One project that I'm very, very looking forward to is the solar car competition that's going to take place in Egypt in the month of March. And I believe you will have about 12 participants from five countries, one of which is from India.
They have marathon as well, the bikes marathons.
That's
and,
right.
Yeah,
so this
that's quite
interesting.
A solar-powered
car, which will start off from Hurghada, Soma Bay, travel to Aswan, and then come into Cairo at the end of its journey.
Yeah.
So there are very many exciting opportunities possible.
And unconventional ways, actually, of marketing Egypt. You know?
Yes. In my embassy, we will soon be launching a startup competition for young Egyptians.
Great.
And the idea is to nurture them within the resources of the embassy and then link them up with potential incubators back in India. Because in India, the concept of innovation and startups has become very, very strong now.
Mm-hmm.
And I think we would both benefit by this kind of exchange.
Are we going to see film stars in India more frequent in Cairo?
Film stars in India?
Mm-hmm.
We have recently seen a spurt of Egyptian movies going to India and winning awards, but we still haven't seen any of the film stars going to India.
Yeah, we would love to see more of that. That's more of people to people as well, you know.
I agree.
Art transcends boundaries.
Exactly.
Yeah. Mm.
You know, I think there is a great opportunity. Cairo hosts what is perhaps the largest and most prestigious film festival in the entire region, the Cairo Film
Cairo
Festival.
Cairo International, yeah.
And it would be a tremendous opportunity to have some of the leading film stars. I remember in 1992, Mr. Amitabh Bachchan had paid his first visit to Egypt as a guest of the Cairo Festival.
Yes, and that was historic, you know.
And then it set off a love affair that the Bachchan family has with Egypt. And
how
as
is
you
this,
know, he's very keen to come again with his family.
Right, right. And how is this love affair going to, like, transcend to other other love stories in, I mean, in the different locations, touristic locations? We would have loved definitely to see Bachchan by the pyramids, but Egypt is not only the pyramids. Siwa Oasis, in Aswan and its beauty, Hurghada, you know? Name it.
Exactly.
Egypt has it all.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, I think we are both such beautiful countries with such lovely societies and people. We've had the first film, Egyptian film, that has been shot, filmed in India. And it was a huge box office hit when it was released last Ramadan. And now, as we speak, there is the second Egyptian film, which has traveled to India. To do part of its shooting over there. And I'm sure when it comes back, it'll come back with very, very good experiences. It is equally important to have a similar exchange happen once again. You know, there was a time when a number of Indian films were filmed, they were shot in Egypt. And it is time that we get the films back.
Yes.
And for Egypt to invite these film stars and bring them back. So that they can again capture the imagination.
Definitely, we need to recapture again this creative mood.
Exactly.
Yeah, definitely. And in music as well, and in sharing in the Cairo Opera House events too.
So this year for India by the Nile, if I'm not letting out a secret, we are planning
We need more secrets tonight.
we are planning something a little different for the finale, in which we will bring in three different compositions which are essentially rooted in India's classical tradition of music and dance. One of them will be a classical dance based but in a contemporary context, which is a dance formation. The music item will be a very famous, an extremely famous classical musician.
Okay.
Who has won awards across the world, who's played a lot of very famous fusion with leading stars from the Western music fraternity. And the last one will be, again, a pure classical dance composition, but this will be a composition which has three different classical dance forms. Into the same composition. So I think Cairo Opera House at the end of April, on the 19th, 20th, and 21st, 18, 19, 20 of April, will see a spectacle of Indian classical dance and music, which is, I think, going to be unparalleled.
Fascinating.
Yeah.
We're expecting.
Anywhere in the world.
We're expecting with the way, Excellency, you know, you're talking with passion, with great passion about the event. So we're looking forward to that as well. Before ending our fruitful discussion, let me know more about your priorities in 2017. You know, how are you prioritizing the agenda? Which comes first? Definitely the bond, the friendship bond between both countries is fascinating. And actually, the strategic relations are in the most wonderful form. How are we going to proceed?
You know, I think the last visit of President Sisi has laid down a very, very ambitious charter for us to implement. So I will be looking at continuing the high-level engagement. We are currently preparing for certain ministerial exchanges, which will take the implementation agenda forward, and we will then work towards continuing the high-level engagement. We're also looking at a much closer collaboration on the defense and security field. I mentioned the exchanges between the NSAs has brought about a much closer cooperation in the field of cyber security and counterterrorism in particular. On the economic field, I think we will be looking at this fantastic exchange of business delegations, which will then lead to investments and trade. But I think the most beautiful part is the cultural exchanges. My agenda for this will include not just the India by the Nile, which is, of course, our flagship
event. Egypt by the Ganga. We're looking forward to that.
All Egyptians to come and witness this fantastic spectacle towards the end of April in the Cairo Opera House and various other events across Egypt. But I think what we will be doing is we will be participating in every regional festival over here. We will also be bringing in an Indian dance teacher in the course of the year. And we are particularly looking forward to that because I think it will give a new dimension to the practice of Bollywood dance over here.
Definitely, it is going to energize the beat, and we're looking forward to that. Lots of colorful events tonight.
In fact, I find that some of the festivals have now overlapped. Holi, which is an Indian festival of color, is now as much an Egyptian festival. And I'm so excited about that.
We are excited too. And thank you very much, Excellency, for bringing that color to the 68th celebration of the Republic Day of India tonight. Thank you very much, Excellency Ambassador Sanjay Bhattacharyya, India's ambassador to Egypt. It's an honor to have you and honor to celebrate with you the special day in India's history, the 68th Republic Day. Thank you so much for coming.
It's always a great pleasure being here, and I wish all your viewers Happy Republic Day. And we look forward to working together with the friendly people of Egypt towards making this bond much closer and much more beautiful.
Definitely much closer and much beautiful, and the sky is the limit in our strategic relations. Thank
Absolutely.
You so much.
Thank you very much.
And that was our special episode of The Debate celebrating the 68th India's Republic Day. I'm Taghreed Hussain. Many thanks for watching.